Hello and good afternoon, everyone. I'm pretty new to this streaming thing. My name is Michael. I work for Near4j in the drivers team. And as the corona epidemic has canceled a couple of conferences for me, and I'm actually quite unsure how I feel with doing stuff online, just alone in front of a camera, I thought it would be a pretty nice idea to try out a couple of things in an informal way on this Twitch account. So, and this is where we are today. What I wanted to do is the following. I'm working at the Spring Data team at Neo4j. We are creating the Spring Data integration and the Spring integration for the Java driver that is used to connect from a Java program to a Neo4j database. And I often hear questions about how Spring Boot works, how Spring Data works. And well, in many conferences you see people going to start.spring.io, which is a fantastic site. I'm gonna show you how that looks. This is the Spring Initializer. The thing that allows you to create a Spring Boot project. You can select dependencies here, for example, WebMVC. And depending on what you select over there, a couple of things happens. And sometimes they feel like magic. They are not really explainable. I've given talk about that stuff, actually, already like 5 years ago. I still like it very much. There are many new approaches or different approaches to application frameworks these days, but I'm still a very big fan of that Spring ecosystem for a couple of reasons. Today, I'm going to try it the other way around. I'm going to start very simple with writing a Java application, which is today like totally different than when I started writing Java. That was 20 years ago. A few weeks ago, Java 14 has been released. This is out in the wild from Oracle, from Open as an Open JDK and a couple of other forms. And I've installed it on my machine. I have a couple of little shell aliases that allows me to switch between JDKs. And back in the day, there was a lot of ceremony to get started with a Java program. That is actually over since JDK 9 with the JEP 222, which was about a cool tool named JShell. You can invoke a Java shell, which is basically a read evaluate loop that takes your input, reads it, evaluates it, compiles it in this case to Java and executes it. For example, the infamous Hello World program can be written as such. And then you can do stuff with that greeting. So I didn't use the string keyword here. I use the var keyword. This is something new in Java 11, I thought it was. It is the type inference. Comes in handy in a couple of things, a couple of places. I'm not using it that often, only if I'm not caring about the return type of a thing. Okay? So that's Java. As I said, I'm working for Neo4j. And Neo4j creates a graph database. Graph databases are about not storing data as tables, but data as actual relations. And Neo4j represents a property graph. Property graph is made of nodes or of nodes and relationships or vertices and edges. And we need a running database to actually access it. my preferred way of getting a database up and running is actually the version where I use Docker. So I have local Docker installed on my machine, and this is the command that creates a running container from an image called Neo4j in version 403, and it takes the internal port 7474 and publishes it on the same port as well. And the same goes for 7687. And with the minus e switch, I define an environment variable that is used to switch the password of the default user. So the thing says me that a local remote interface is available at that URL. We can go there. And enter the credentials. As I've shown you in the Docker command, we use the super secret password secret here. Okay, sorry, I didn't notice when the video died. Let's try this again. I turned off everything not necessary on my machine. Due to performance reasons. Yes, we're back. We're looking at the browser backend that comes with Neo4j. I ended up saying that the database is empty as I didn't mount any directories into it. We can use some simple commands to create data. For example, the create command is used to create nodes. We can give them names. And the arrows are used to create relationships. And we can define something we call whatever project. And I also work on that project. Come to that later on. So what I did now was create three nodes, two person nodes and one project node, and you have a beautiful backend which you can use to explore the data set. So, but this stream shouldn't be about the database itself. It's a great product, but there are folks much better in explaining the product than I am. I'm gonna use the built-in movie graph. With the play command, you can bring up a couple of helpful tutorials that guide you through using the product. And one of those is the movie graph. The movie graph contains a couple of movies and people. And the people either acted or directed the movie. So we can click through it like this, and you get a really huge Cypher query. Cypher is the query language that is used to interact with Neo4j. And now I have a really huge graph of movies, the Green Mile, what we have here, Castaway, the Da Vinci Code, Apollo 13, centered around the actor Tom Hanks, which got picked up for whatever reason as a default. And that will be the data set I'm going to work with in my Java application. So back to the J shell. I wonder, can I create a Hello World program using only the J shell to interact with Neo4j? Turns out I can. I'm going to leave this. And What we need here is the Neo4j Java driver. And the Neo4j Java driver comes as two Java libraries, which is the driver itself, the Neo4j Java driver, and the reactive stream specification. So for those interested in, we would have preferred to deliver one single artifact here, but it's very hard or nearly impossible to shade a dependency like the reactive stream specification, because that dependency is a specification. If I would shade them into one single jar, then I would have to, if I do it right, to rename the packages. And if it's in a different package, then it's not the original specification anymore. So that's the reason why we don't have a single binary dependency. To get that into the J shell, I have to define a class path variable like this. And then I can recall my J shell like this, but I'm also using the preview feature. Enable preview is a feature in the newer JDK versions that allows us to do a couple of cool things that the Java of old didn't allow us to do. For example, we can create multi-line strings. They are started with three quotation marks, and then we can enter a new line and create a cipher query like this. Match. The match keyword is used to match things, in this case movie notes, and we return the title of the movie as the only interested attribute for the time being. And I think that's a very cool feature of JDK 14. It's in the JDK since 11, I think. Oh, that's the neighbor's dogs. And you see, it even takes into account the non-necessary leading white spaces. Still a preview feature in JDK 14, but I think it should be enabled soon. Anyway. So how to interact with Neo4j? I need something that is called driver. I get the driver from those packages, or Neo4j driver, and the J shell has auto completion, and this is the factory method that you are using to get an instance of a connection to our database. The protocol Neo4j speaks is called the Bolt protocol, and it's listening on 7687, the default port for Bolt. Auth tokens is a way to say hello, I'm the user Neo4j using the password secret, and I now have a driver connected to that database. This is a thing that the driver, that's a thing that should be later in the hour injected by Spring Boot for us. How to use it? Turns out it's pretty simple. I can open up a session like this. This is by default a general purpose read and write session. We do have read-only sessions, those are interesting in working with cluster scenarios. And we do also have asynchronous sessions and reactive sessions. There's been a tech talk yesterday by my colleague Greg, who spoke about in detail about our reactive database support, but that's not something I can write without exercising too much upfront and speaking about it. So I'm using the plain imperative session here for demonstrating those things. And on the session I can then execute queries like the cipher query I defined, a cipher, okay, and then I can just close it. Let's see what happened. Oh, cool. Of course, it's totally wrong. I need to use the equals sign here, and then I can traverse the result, which is an internal record type, and I can, for example, print it. And that's just the API of our driver. Now I have all the movies. Okay. So far. And that's basically how you interact with Neo4j from Java, the most simplistic way. I'm not saying it's simple, it's rather simplistic, and it's a friendly API. So let's see how we can actually create a project from it. We already needed to do a couple of things here. We needed to declare dependencies, the Neo4j driver jar, and the reactive stream specifications. I needed to create a instance of a driver that is now available in that running JShell tool, but in a real application it needs to be made available for the whole application during the lifetime of the application. And we also need to take care of closing the thing. Right? I can do this like this. That's my own responsibility to do it. I mean, if I just close the JShell, then the Java process terminates and the driver will be closed anyway. But that's maybe something you should take care of consciously in your application. So over to the application and something shareable for later today. I'm using the IntelliJ EDA to create a project, and I'm using the current early access preview, which supports JDK 14 and all the preview features. So by hitting new project, I get a couple of options here. I can create projects without any dependency management, plain Java project, couple of other platforms here. I think the Spring platform here creates a project that's more like the Spring projects of old without Spring Boot. Then you can jump over to the Spring Boot initializer. If I'm gonna hit this one, it's gonna use the same website and the same API I've shown earlier in the browser. You can also run this thing on your own machines if you want to customize the initializer. That's also some very nice feature. And I can just create plain Maven or Gradle projects. Both Maven and Gradle are, I'm probably gonna get burned for it, but I'd say both tools are both dependency management and build tools. People are using Maven or Gradle to declare the dependencies of their project, as well as to define how a project is built. I'm more of a Maven person. I like that tool and I know it, and that's the reason I'm using it. Your mileage with Gradle is maybe different than mine. Both tools do their job. I don't have much preferences over those. If I would use Maven more often, then I probably choose Gradle if I use Gradle more often. So anyway, long story short, just create a project here based on Maven, call it Neo4j Twitch, I think it's a good name. A Maven project usually lives under a set of coordinates. I'm gonna use my thing I'm using always for Neo4j, and yeah, the artifact name seems just fine. Make it a bit better. So that's probably the most simple Question is on the Slack, in the chat, if I can code a video game with it. Maybe. That's most. Just wanted to say that's probably the most simplest Maven project I can think of. It's only defining the group and the coordinates under which the project itself lives. To make it work with JDK 14, we have to define a couple of properties here. The properties being the Maven. I have to look this up. I'm cheating here. The Maven compiler source version, which is source, and the Maven compiler target, which should also be 14. So the thing is empty. Nope, yeah. IntelliJ created a couple of standard folders for a Maven project, which is a convention that there's a source and a test, there's a source folder containing both main and test folders, both again Java for Java source files and resources for other sources. Let's create a simple Java class here, call it, give it some name, some package name. Say it's a rough application. Rebuilding what we did in the J shell. Would look something like this. Now I have a runnable application. And I also can take my query from before, or I can just define the query again. I think I messed up the compiler. Do I need to re-import this? I think so. No, that's just great. I think I'm gonna cheat a bit. I always forget the names of those properties that sets the compiler. It's actually the right properties, maven.compiler, source and target. Why is it complaining? I need a name. Makes sense, actually. Okay. Let's go to the module settings. Switch expression, just enable the preview. Yeah, IntelliJ is right at this point. I've set the language level correctly to 14, but I didn't enable the preview settings. Let's just do that. The preview settings or compiler settings in the Maven project are enabled or configured with a plugin, which is the Maven compiler plugin. Those can be declared like this. They also live under coordinates, which are artifacts and groups. So we use Maven compiler plugin here. Get some nice auto completion. Use the latest one. And say we want to configure it with some compiler. Why do I actually like three of them? Compiler args arguments and arguments. I'm gonna go with the first one, enable preview, re-import a thing, and now everything is green. Now back to my query. The query should give me all the movies, all the movies. and the people who are acting in a movie. Just give this thing's name. So I'm not gonna explaining our query language all too much. I think if you're interested in that stuff, you probably know Neo4j. Otherwise, I can refer you to more streams later on. So, and we add some more interesting stuff like filtering the results. This is a regular expression, and this is how a parameter placeholder would look like in Cypher. And we then return the title of the movie, its title, and again the person's name as name. So there's feedback. I should zoom in, of course I can. Hope this is better. If I want to use the graph database, I cannot do this right now because I didn't declare my dependencies. So dependencies are declared in the dependencies block of a Maven build file. And the dependencies we are looking for is the Neo4j Java driver. And the latest version is 4.01, and that's about it. And for people who never work with a dependency management tool, this brings in both the jar files we've seen on the command line beforehand. This brings in the main artifact as well as the reactive stream specification. I think we can have a look in the diagrams here. That's interesting. That didn't work well. Try again. Now we see the dependencies of our project. And that's what a dependency management tool is for. There are a couple of things we're going to change later, for example, that version number here. Anyway, with that in place, I can now use the graph database factory. I cannot. That's interesting. Okay, that's great. Very much in the same way I did in the JShell beforehand. I'm doing this in a so-called try-catch block, and in a try-catch block that is a specialty in this case, it's a try with resources block. Everything I'm gonna open in that try block is a resource that is closed automatically for me when the block is left. That's also the case if anything happens with an error in that block. So it's movies label should be movie. Yeah, that's true. Good point. Again, I can open up a couple of resources here. I'm going to open the session as well. So that try with resources block here closes those for me. And I can now run my query. Choose that one. And I'm going to use a map of movie title like Matrix. That's probably interesting. Okay, if I run this now, I shouldn't see any output actually. So my colleague actually knows that my machine is kind of slow, especially when doing some video related stuff, and I don't know what's happening. It's just compiling and parsing. Give it a couple of seconds. So the only output I'm seeing is that the driver is connected and closing. That's because we didn't do anything with it. We can just stream the records here. Get something from the record, the title, and also get played in. If I rerun this now, I'm gonna see some output of actors which played in in movies. See, played in. Ah, this is actually case sensitive. So those of you who are waiting for Spring Boot, we're gonna get to it, but I'm just gonna build this step by step as promised. So executing queries in that way is possible if you connect it to a cloud instance of Neo4j, for example our product or the cluster you're running. You maybe want to have something that we call transactional functions. Transactional functions are things that should be passed to a cluster, and on the cluster or on that server, they are executed as a whole. For that purpose, they need to be idempotent. That means they, in case of an error, they are executed a couple of times until they succeed, as long as they are not errors in the query itself. So they need to be executable at least twice. Right. I'm gonna show that how it looks. Transactional function give stuff back, and we are now, I want to define something that I call a movie record, like this. Record is a new keyword in Java 14, and this is a new class type definition that is similarly restricted to an enum. It has not the full power of a class, but it comes with a couple of benefits. For example, it is immutable, it has automatically accessors for getting attributes, it has sane equals and hash codes and even a string method. So I can declare a record like this. Movie has a title and a list of people acted in that movie. Okay. So a compiler error because there is no person yet. Let's create a record person. I just write it down here. And the thing should have a name. And we need to import that. So, and the function I'm going to write should give back a list of movies. It can be static. Call it find movies and their actors in a transaction. Where is it? Transaction. Transaction class, that's too bad. Let's see, what does TF, it has type of transaction yet. I I wonder if this is an issue with the preview of PPJ, because the import is there anyway. So the transaction can be used as a query runner as well. So I copy over my query to that place and then run the query again with the parameters. And just delete from here. And this time I'm not gonna do something with all the records. I'm gonna list the records, the driver records in this case, and now we're gonna do a bit of cool cipher here. I can actually collect stuff as lists, so that I can avoid the n plus one query problem in this case. I just have a simple query that returns my movie and all the actors, and it automatically groups by everything that is not collected. So I have a movie, title in this case, and all the actors, and let's see what we can do with that one. I can retrieve the actors from the result row or record, and that thing is a list actually, and I can use that to create an actual person. Get, yes, I think it's a string, and I'm not in Kotlin mode here. I still have to add a new, so that would make my list of actors. Should even compile, I think. And now I have to create the movie itself. And we retrieve the title. I'm too fast for IntelliJ. It appears. And we can return the movie. Add some of those magic sprinkling semicolons and return the whole stuff. So I've now created a idempotent find movie and the actors method that runs query in a transaction, takes the result and maps it to my data model, which is currently made up of a movie and a person. So let's see if that actually works. I pass that method here as a method handle to the retransaction method, and I should now have a list of movies which I can iterate. Movies for each. So you might notice, I didn't write any accessors or toString method here. And let's see if that actually gives us a nicely formatted result. So I found like all the three matrix movies with all the actors here. The matrix, matrix reloaded, and matrix revolutions. I think that's story unconfirmed yet that Emil actually played in the movie, but it's a nice joke. So that's my business. I have a running Java application. I would create a driver as necessary, which would be very slow because that's an expensive operation. It opens up a connection, authenticates against the database. I've also have like these hard-coded string values here, the host and the authentication, and a couple of more things. So imagine I followed any Java conference in the world the last 4 or 5 years. I've seen folks presenting about Spring Boot and how easy it is, and I want to try this out. But I also want to see what's happening when I go to Start.Spring.io. Start.Spring.io doesn't do actually that much. I think I can even stick into my EDA here and do it myself. So what Spring Initializer does is it creates a very well-defined project definition. It doesn't matter if it's Gradle or Maven, the principles are the same. In Maven, it's resolved with the parent POM mechanism, so a build file can either have a packaging of Java artifact or another build file, a POM, which I can inherit from. In the Gradle world, it's done via plugins, but doesn't matter. I bring in something that does two things for me. One is it manages my dependencies so that I don't have to take care of the versioning here myself. This is especially true that there's dependency management for all versions Spring related. Spring Boot and Spring Framework itself are not mutually exclusive, quite the contrary. Spring Boot builds upon Spring Framework. And a lot of other modules in the Spring area, like Spring Security, Spring Data, Spring Batch and whatnot, also build on top of Spring Framework. So all the things that gets orchestrated here, they need to have well-defined versions fitting with each other. So in the Maven world, this is done via dependency management defined in a parent project. And the parent project is a little surprising called Spring Boot Parent, and it comes from that group, and we're gonna use the latest and greatest version. And we resolve it from the parent. So this thing is not yelling at me anymore. So that's kinda cool. Do I have already a Spring Boot project? Well, kind of. If I would go to start.spring.io, I would see one more thing. I would see an additional build plugin added, which is, I have to look this one up, this is the Spring Boot Maven. Oh, thanks for nothing. Let's talk with the good buddy. Org Spring Framework Boot. It is managed. Why are you at Spring Boot even plugin? So the version of that plugin is also managed by everything that comes with the parent here. Okay. We can actually look into the parent by just clicking it. And the Spring Boot parent project is not actually at the very top of the line. It depends on Spring dependencies, in which you find a lot of properties. More properties, even more properties. And then at some point, you find that tag, that important tag here, which takes care of defining versions of Java libraries that works neatly with each other. I've written a blog post about that one. I'm gonna add links to all that stuff into that repository and gonna share that repository later on, but that's something really important to understand what dependency management is. It resolves dependency clashes for you. It can give you a sane set of versions that are known to work well with each other. And I think it's one of the most important things that Spring Boot actually does for all the projects it manages. So are we there yet? Not finally. The starter, the Spring Initializer, adds at least one dependency, which is the Spring Boot starter. And now we are getting to where it's interesting. Spring Boot Starter actually comes again with a handful of aspects to it. Oh, I should not forget it. I have an easier way of defining the Java version used when using the Spring Boot parent project. It reads java.version and sets the source and target versions in a consistent way for me. So just change it. What I was saying, the starter comes in again to the, it has two responsibilities. One is it does something like automatic configuration, and the second is it aggregates dependencies for a given purpose. The most simple starter here, the Spring Boot starter, comes with the absolute necessary set of dependencies needed. Again, I think I need to refresh it. Close it. This is the absolute minimum number of dependencies to run a Spring Boot application. So you find the Spring Boot starter depending on auto configuration, depending on Spring Boot, depending on the Spring context, the aspect oriented programming facilities, and the Spring Beans. That area here, these three dependencies, is the heart of Spring Framework. Heart of Spring Framework is actually quite simple. Heart of Spring's framework is dependency injection, something that allows you to declare singleton beans of a couple of various types and have their life cycle managed. So when do they start up, when they are closed or destroyed, and how they are injected into things. Apart from that, we find dependencies on Spring Boot Starter logging, which allows for nice logging configuration. And that's basically all. Great, now everything is red. Why is that? That's interesting. I added Spring and everything goes red. Maybe that wasn't the best idea, setting the version like this. I thought it was the right way to do it. Java version. That's interesting. Now it's getting better again. That's really interesting. Oh, this is fascinating. Java.version. Maybe it's because I did this. I don't know what I'm doing wrong with setting the version here, java.version. Fascinating. I maybe cheat again by going to the initializer. It has some nice things to do here. I can explore stuff. Basically the same as I did before. Same version. Thought I would be able to do this. Have the compiler plugin. Just set the preview mode. Still don't want my Java 14. That's highly irritating to to say at least. Anyway, and I'm gonna stick with those settings and gonna find about it out later. To turn that thing into a Spring Boot application, the last step to bring up the Spring context is adding that magical, super powerful annotation. That annotation does tons of things. It is itself annotated with a couple of other annotations. The three here, those are language specifics, but those three, they have a lot content of them. The first one makes it a configuration for Spring. The second one enables the magic of a Spring Boot starter, something that's called auto configuration. And the last one enables component scan. That means the Spring context is looking for everything that Spring knows or understands. Spring understands classes that are annotated with at component, at service, at repository, or at configuration. So if I would want to have my Neo4j driver into something externally, I would go with a Neo4j configuration and add configuration to it. That's a class that is now found when the Spring context starts up. And any method annotated with add bean, the return value of any method that's annotated with add bean would be a bean, would become a bean in the Neo4j context, Spring context. So we're gonna make our driver a managed bean. So I'm just gonna steal that driver from here and return it over there. Then I of course don't need all that. And now through the add component scan, Spring searches for everything that's at configuration. It also searches for at service, at repository, or at controller. There are a couple of more stereotypes. Also, the most generic one, I think it's at component. That would be a very stupid idea doing like this. So I'm just running this as a configurational component. So that means somewhere when the application starts up, we should have a driver bean. Okay, then we need something that's actually runnable, and we create a new class for it, which we called query runner. One-time query runner. I think that's a pretty decent Java name. And let's implement an interface. It's a command line runner. Command line runner also comes from a Spring framework, also in this case from Spring Boot. And it's a thing that's executed once after application starts up. So I'm gonna copy query and also the data model. I'm gonna put it away from my main application and put it into that class. Can also make non-inner records from it. I think that's the nicest way of doing things. So to execute a query again, I need the driver. But this time, I'm going to use a member variable here. This thing has to come from where, and I'm going to use a standard Java constructor. No Spring annotations involved in any place at this point. Yeah, and that's about it. I have two options here. I can manually instantiate that class. That's super nice for example, testing. If I would write a unit test for it, I can bring up my driver any way I like. I am not dependent on the Spring framework here at all. So that's so much for the voices saying Spring is not testable. That's a component here that's testable as easy as it gets when a database is involved. But on the one time, it's actually something that works with a Spring application. I'm too lazy to instantiate my own. I'm just annotated with add component. So let's have a look at the chat. Oh, thanks, Michael. I'm gonna see. Have a look at the chat later on. So just gonna grab the last bits of the main application here and just dump it into that one. So that method handle is now wrong. It's one time query runner. Just remove that configuration. And off we go. We don't fail. Just declare I don't fail here. And yeah. I now have a Spring component that runs a query and does nothing more. The main application now looks pretty empty. That's at least for me a quite decent look. To jump into the Spring context, we're gonna use the run method of a class called Spring application and pass that. And I think we need to pass the arguments as well. So, and that's basically what you get if you go to start.spring.io. Let's see, I'm gonna explore here a bit more. This is called demo application. Surprisingly, the main application looks exactly the same like mine. And I think that's a pretty, as I said, pretty good look for a Spring main application. You don't need to add much more to it because by default, the starters take care of it. If your main application starts growing and growing and growing, it's maybe some sign that you should rethink that application and pull out stuff into something called labeled as configuration. Let's see if that stuff still runs. Building. Let's kind of look at the chat. So now I not only have the famous Spring logo, the banner here, I have some information about the Spring application starting up. I get information which Spring version I'm running, this one. And as you see, the driver now uses the Spring JCL logging as well. And then I have the output. The only reason that application doesn't terminate yet is because the driver starts a couple of background threads that we would have to terminate in order to make the context aware, the Spring context aware to shut itself down afterwards, after running this command line thing. So we are on top of the hour. I promised to go to auto configuration, and that's the last thing I'm gonna do for today. I'm gonna switch this dependency here, which is the driver dependency, and only it, to something called Neo4j Red4j Java driver Spring Bootstarter. And also on that version. I think the best practices for stuff that is not yet managed with Spring Boot is to define properties for those versions. There's a handy refactoring in IntelliJ which is called property, and it does exactly that, creates a property and replaces the constant with the variable. And so the Neo4j Java driver Spring Boot Starter, again, I'm German, this is Java, Java and Spring, the names have to be long, but it's just the way things are. It's a Java driver for Neo4j and Spring Boot, so, and it's a naming conversion. That's something we've written at Neo4j, and it's not exactly the same thing you find on the Spring Initializer. If you go to the dependencies here, you find Spring Data Neo4j. That starter brings you a couple of things more. It also brings you Spring Data, it brings you Neo4j OGM, and not only the pure database connection. We are working closely with VMware to get that stuff also into the initializer, or to restructure a couple of things. From my perspective, if you only need database connection, this is the way to go, adding that starter. If you want to have Spring Data Neo4j on top of it, they both work together. The Spring Data Neo4j starter you get from start.spring.io recognizes the presence of the pure database connection and acts accordingly. So that would be no deal to migrate from one to the other. For today, we're gonna focus on that one. Okay. So what I wanted to achieve is to get rid of code I've written. I want to get rid of this Neo4j configuration. And I do this by something that's brought in with the Neo4j Java driver starter, which is downloading sources, zoom again, which is called Neo4j driver auto configuration. So if you bring in a starter to a Spring Boot application, it Spring Boot first has to recognize, hey, there is a new starter on the class path. It would be super slow to scan every class on the class path, so it looks for something it finds in, let's zoom in a bit, it finds in the meta inf directory of jar files, and it's a very simple file called Spring Factories, and it uses a similar version or a similar thing to the Java service loader. Under some well-defined key, in this case Org Spring Framework Boot Auto Configure, enable auto configuration, you find a list of classes that should be automatically loaded when the Spring context starts up. In this case, it's the driver auto configuration and driver metrics, and also contributors to the Spring Boot health endpoints. So Spring Boot does that for all the libraries, and it finds in the Java driver Spring Boot starter that file, and it goes to this class here, and you find that add configuration annotation again. Oh wait, so we have been at the add Spring Boot application annotation beforehand. That mechanism of loading spring.factories and everything connected to it is triggered by add enable auto configuration. So that's the whole magic of Spring Boot Starter. And then there's mechanisms of doing conditional configurations. What do we have for conditions here? To be able to configure a Neo4j driver, I need to have the driver class on the class path. I can also control in which order things are configured, but that's more advanced stuff. I don't go into the detail right now. So, and I've then imported configuration file, which only does stuff when there's no such bean of a type driver. And it only does stuff when some property is set. That property here being prefix with org Neo4j driver and the URI. That needs to be set so that the auto configuration triggers in. And that's basically all the auto configuration for the driver here does. It does the same like you would do manually, but in a way that is maintained by us and it's always updated by us. One more nice thing coming with the Spring Boot starters are externalized configuration. So in the manual configuration, I only used the driver URI and username and password, but the driver has actually a couple of things that are configurable. And those things are mapped to a configuration class, which is called Neo4j driver properties. Again, lives under a prefix. It has some documentations on it, right? Java doc, standard Java doc. Couple of things here. You can use Kerberos for authentication. You can specify if metrics should be enabled, stuff like that. Lot of things. Nothing you should have to remember. That's what we are doing at the company. So to make this work now, properties in a Spring application can come from properties files, a little surprisingly. Some people prefer YAML. I don't. I like those properties files, actually. And I have in every EDE out there, being it NetBeans, IntelliJ, or Eclipse, auto-completion for that stuff. And not only for ours, of course, for everything that official Spring Boot starters configure, but also for other external projects. So the Spring ones you will find under the Spring prefix. I mean, you find tons of interesting things here. You find Juke, you find Batch, JTR, whatever. And you can configure the URL to connect to. Let's do an interesting experiment. Connect to the host 7687, but on FUBA. Question is, will my application fail? Will it run? Let's see. The tension rises. Yep, indeed. So funny thing is, the application runs, although there is no host named FUBA in my network. Why is this? So that's could be something that people might find annoying working with Spring, because things happen. But actually, it's not hidden away. You can go to your run configuration. I did this right now in IntelliJ, but the parameter is quite simple. It's --- debug, and you get tons of debug information. Let's see what it tells me. So I think this needs to be bigger now. What we find here is an auto configuration report. Wow, look at this. This is a report of what conditions have been evaluated. And you'll find a list of positive matches, things that are enabled now, and a list of negative matches. So our connection didn't fail. Did this here even trigger in? Let's have a look for Neo4j. So we find Neo4j under negative matches. The driver configuration says it did not match because conditional on missing bean of type driver already found beans of a type driver. There was one positive match, which was the URI I defined. So Spring Boot is actually quite helpful on debugging stuff. That tells me, hey, I wanted to get rid of this. I didn't. So what is happening? This bean has precedence over something that the auto configuration gives you. So it's basically what's saying here. Do this stuff only if that condition evaluates to true. So easy fix here is just delete stuff.